Hello friends and welcome to PathFinderIAS Club. My name is Sachin and in this video we will discuss ARC report number 6, that is local governance. This topic is important for the society part of GS1, governance part of GS2 and governance related topics of GS4 if you see broadly. Before we start, you should know local governance include both PRI as well as ULBs, that is Panchayati Raj institutions at local level as well as urban local bodies like municipality, municipal corporation and all that. Definition of governance, you can write it down. Activity of decision making by public representatives and public authorities for the utilization of resources for the welfare of society. You can get this type of definitions, good definitions from UNDP reports as well. Okay, so now we'll see what exactly we are going to see in this video. Here you can see the index. First part we'll see local self-governance, evolution and growth. Second, core principles of local governance. Then we'll discuss features of 73rd and 74th constitutional amendment. Then we'll see impact of constitutional amendment particularly on society. Then challenges of local governance, significant recommendations and interesting concepts and terms which you can use in the answers, maybe in the introduction or maybe in the conclusion. Okay, so now let's begin today's discussion. Here in ancient India, if you see, in the Chola kingdoms, the village councils with its sub-committees and wards played important part in administration, arbitrated disputes and managed social affairs. From the ancient part, we have chosen only Chola kingdom. There are other examples as well. But like if you take more examples from ancient history, then it will sound like a history lecture and not that of local governance. So we'll just stick to Chola as of now. Then we'll come to the modern history. The present structure of local government institutions took shape in 1688 when British established a municipal corporation at Madras, which was followed by creation of similar bodies at Bombay and Calcutta in 1726. Okay. After that, in 1872, Lord Mayo introduced elected representatives for these municipalities, and this was further developed by his successor, Lord Ripon. Now, for prelims point of view, we should know two facts important here, that Lord Mayo is related to the financial decentralization and Lord Ripon is related to democratic decentralization. Okay, so there is slight difference between both of these viceroys. Then the Minto Morley reforms in 1909 and Montague Clemson reforms in 1919 widen the participation of people in the governing process, and by 1924-25 district boards had a preponderance of elected representatives and a non-official chairman. This arrangement continued till late 1950s. All the reforms which British introduced, they have expanded the scope and expanded the size of council over the period of time. Okay, so it was always in the positive progression towards decentralization and local participation. Okay, we'll move forward now. Panchayati Raj institutions would find place in DPSP, that's Directive Principles of State Policy, Article 40. Then, in compliance with the Article 40, establishment of village panchayat as unit of self-government, an ambitious rural sector initiative, that is Community Development Program, was launched in 1952. Okay, see, post-independence, these activities are very important. First, Panchayati Raj institution, then Community Development Program. Then in 1956, when second five-year plan was launched, it recommended that the village panchayat should be organically linked with the popular organization at the higher level, which means at district level, state level, and ultimately to the center. To operationalize this initiative, government appointed Balwantra Mehta Committee in 1957. Okay, after that, unfortunately, after the intensive stage of community development program, there was a visible trend towards centralization. Okay, as we have seen here, it should be linked with the popular organization, but it led to centralization. Panchayati Raj elections were postponed indefinitely. That is even seen today also in Tamil Nadu. And the flow of funds for the block development were reduced through a trickle. Then in 1977, government formed Ashok Mehta Committee to go with working to go into the working of Panchayat Raj institutions and to suggest measures to strengthen them into effective local apparatus for decentralized planning and development. This word is very important, decentralized planning and development of the rural area. And finally, in 1992, after synthesizing important features of earlier exercises on this subject, government drafted and introduced 73rd and 74th Amendment Bill in Parliament. Okay. So we have reached till 73rd and 74th Amendment, which is the like core part of this discussion. Before moving on to the features of the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment, we will discuss what are the core principles of local governance. You can see here there are 6 core principles. We will discuss each one of them briefly, okay, because this is a short video. First of all, subsidiarity. What exactly subsidiarity means? It is a principle that a central authority should have a subsidiarity function, performing only those tasks which cannot be performed at the more local level. For example, defense and diplomacy, which can be handled only at the central level, not at the state level. Okay, that is what subsidiarity means. Then second one, democratic decentralization. It means, it refers to the permanent devolution of decision-making power to the local bodies. It should be guided by 4 norms. These 4 norms are given in this report. First, voters should be aware of the consequences of the election in terms of public good. Second norm, there should be clear link between the resource generation and outcome in the form of better services provided to the citizens. Third norm, it should lead to the reducing of asymmetry of power in society. And fourth norm for the democratic decentralization is locus of power should shift close to the people as possible. Okay, that is the only purpose of democratic decentralization. Then the next point is delineation of functions. Delineation of functions as divided in 7th schedule between union and state should be followed. Like all the listed subjects in the 11th and 12th schedule should be devolved to the local bodies. Okay, that is what delineation means. Then devolution in real terms. Because unless there is availability of fund, function and functionaries, only devolution of functions will not create the positive result. So there should be devolution of fund, function and functionaries as well to the local bodies. Then only it will be effective in the long term. Then convergence. Convergence of existing schemes are more effective than the launching new schemes. And that is all what the present government is focusing on. Instead of giving more schemes, they are utilizing the previous already implemented schemes so that the different schemes will come together for the welfare of people at the local level. Okay, without allocating fund in new schemes. Okay, that is what the function of convergence of schemes here it is. Then the last part is citizen centricity. See, citizen is the heart of democratic system. Therefore, all the government institutions, particularly local government, should be judged by the direct empowerment of the people at the local level. Okay, that is what the citizen centricity means, empowerment of the people. Okay, so we have completed with the core principles of local governance, we'll discuss the features of 73rd and 74th amendment. Okay, here you can see that amendments were passed by Parliament in December 1992. Here the important differentiation between both the amendments: 73rd is for the rural India, 74th for urban. 73rd came into force on April 24. See, April 24 is also celebrated as Panchayat Raj Day. Okay, that is why you can remember this thing. And the 74th amendment came into force on June 1, 1993. 73rd amendment added part 9 titled the Panchayats, and 74th amendment added the part 9A titled the municipalities. Okay, and the last one, 74th amendment enlisted the powers of panchayat were enlisted in schedule 11 and powers of municipalities were enlisted in schedule 12. Okay, now we'll see the common features between both the amendments. Here are the list. See, in this video I have highlighted all the articles in the bold, which are not much importance for the prelims, but these are very important for the mains point of view. Okay, adding facts in the answers gives it improves the value of the answer. We'll see the features now. First one, basic unit of democratic system, that is Gram Sabha at village level and ward committees as at municipalities, comprising all the adult members registered as voters. So this fact is important for the prelims point of view. Adult members registered as voter, this one. And second, three-tier system of panchayat at village, intermediate, there is block, taluk or mandal, and district level, that should be established. Except in the state with the population below 20 lakh, that governor will take call on it. Then next, seats to all the levels to be filled by direct election. Okay, then next, seats reserved for SC and ST and chairperson of the panchayat at all the levels also shall be reserved for the SC and ST in the proportion to their population. This proportion word is important here because it is not uniform throughout the constituencies. Then next one, 1/3 of the total number of seats to be reserved for women. 1/3 of the seats reserved for the SC ST also reserved for the women. Okay, and also for the chairman. Here if you see, there is no there is nothing related to the OBC reservation, because the SC ST reservation is compulsorily, it is mandatory provision of this amendment act, but OBC reservation to the OBC is not mandatory, it is voluntary. So if there is more number of OBCs in the state, they can take a call and give reservation if they want, because local body is after all a state subject. Okay, then we'll move forward. Uniform 5-year term and elections to constitute new bodies to be completed before the expiry of the term. In the event of dissolution, elections compulsorily within the 6 months. Okay, so there is one interesting fact. If suppose there is a panchayat samiti, panchayat body elected in a gram sabha, then that body, it get dissolved in 2 years, then the next panel which come to the power will get only power for 3 years, not complete 5 years. Okay, so the date is fixed every after 5 years in the state. Okay, you getting my point? Like even if it get dissolved in 2 years, the next party will get only, next party in the sense next panel will get only 3 years of term. The next point, independent election commission in each state for the superintendence, direction and control of the electoral roll. Panchayats to prepare plans for economic development and social justice in respect of the subjects as devolved by the law to the various levels of panchayats, including subjects given in 11th schedule. So here also, if you see, the election commission this election commission is independent of the central election commission. Okay, so that is a different thing here. Then 74th amendment provides for the district planning committee, article 243 ZD. For PBAT student, it is important because this is a recurring topic in the planning thing. 74th amendment provides district planning committee to consolidate the plans prepared by panchayat and municipalities. Okay, then few of the last ones. Budgetary allocation for the state governments, share of the revenue of certain taxes, collections and retention of the revenue it raises, central government programs and grants, Union Finance Commission grants. This is mandatory provision. And the last one, establish a finance commission in each state to determine the principle of the principle on the basis of which adequate financial resources would be ensured for panchayats and municipalities. Okay, so state finance commission is established under this amendment. That is important to know for the prelims point of view. Okay, these are the features of the 73rd and 74th amendment. Now we'll see what exactly the impact of this constitutional amendment on the society. First and foremost, women empowerment. Provision of 1/3 reservation provided women an opportunity to participate in the leading role at village level. Okay, then and because of this provision, we have it makes India having highest number of female elected representatives in the world. Okay, because of this provision, in the states like Bihar, there is 50% of the reservation to the women in the local bodies. Okay, so it is like at least 1/3 should be reserved. The next point, SCST upliftment, second round of power is more empowering. See, it has been like 25 years after the 73rd and 74th amendment. So most of the places like SCST are experiencing power for the second round. This time, they are taking political decisions without the help of dominant caste. Earlier, they were dependent on the dominant caste, or maybe dominant caste were overpowering the SCST elected leaders. The next one, people participation in decision making through the Gram Sabha, Ward Sabha, makes the Indian democracy a vibrant one. Okay, people taking decision on their own. So it is a good impact. Then political participation is making people aware of their rights. This is also a good impact. Then last one, success of the good governance initiatives like citizen charter, social audit, RTI, etc. depends upon the active involvement and social movement. Okay, so in this, PRI and ULBs are playing catalytic role in this direction, good governance. So we'll see one of the case study related to the impact of this amendment. See, these are the model villages like Dharnai in Bihar, Pai Bihir in Maharashtra, Hivre Bazar again in Maharashtra, then Odanthurai in Tamil Nadu, Chizami in Nagaland, Ganga Devi Palli in Andhra Pradesh, and Kokrabellur in Karnataka. So I have been to this Hivre Bazar once, so we'll discuss that case study, what exactly I found there. You can see here before and after effect, that is like it was a drought prone area, then it is all greenery here. See, what I found here at Hivre Bazar is there is a because of the constitutional amendment, it got a legal recognition of the leadership at the local level. Okay, and also because of the ability of the leader, he could converge, like what we discussed, convergence of the existing scheme for the benefit of his village. That is very important. And not only that, he got the support from his villagers who could work, like they could give their labor for the welfare of society. Okay, so that is also important. Like it requires social movement. Only one person cannot bring on the difference. Even if he try very hard, he should get support of the villagers. So that is what make a model village. That is what we observe in this village. Okay, we'll move forward now. But everywhere it is not a good green picture. There are few challenges still existing in local governance. For example, we have seen like hardly women participate in the Gram Sabhas. Most of the time only those who got elected, they will be there present. Otherwise non-elected women will not participate. Then dominant caste still take decision at the local level on behalf of elected SC/ST representatives. Though it is not widely spread in South India maybe, but in North it is still prevalent. Then fund function functionaries devolution is not uniform across the states and not sufficient to run local bodies as independent unit that as independent of the state. They are dependent on state for the funds. Okay. Then decision taken are mostly like wish list, that we want to construct the road, we want to this do this and that. They don't invest in the long-term policy for the village. Then many panchayats do not have basic infrastructure like ward office. Okay, this is very basic infrastructure. Then despite constitutional provision of conducting regular elections, there is delayed and pending elections at local bodies even in one of the developed states like Tamil Nadu. These challenges still are there. So to solve these challenges and make local governance more effective, we can see that significant recommendations which are mentioned in this report. The first and foremost, principle of subsidiarity. We have discussed this in the core principles of local governance. Legislative and implementation powers related to the particular subject with power and authority as are necessary to enable them function as institutions of the locals, of the self-government in respect of the all functions. So like a higher authority should devolve power to the lower wherever it is possible. The next one, principle of devolution of power, responsibilities and functions to the local government and communities based on, these are the basic principles which discussed. Okay, democratic decentralization, delineation, devolution, convergence and citizen centricity. We'll move forward. Parastatals should not be allowed to undermine the power of PRI. Next, district rural development agency should be discontinued. See, we have like multiplicity of the institutions at the local level, that there is planning is done by multiple organizations, then again this execution is done by multiple organizations. So that is just increasing the overlapping of the institution functions. To reduce the overlapping, ARC is recommending that district rural development agency should be discontinued with. Then mayor should be directly elected by popular mandate through the citywide election. See, this will make mayor a strong person who can take decisions and lead the city in the right direction. Otherwise, mayor is just a puppet in the hand of a ruling party. Okay, so independent directly elected mayor is, we have seen in the London, even in New York, but only in India it is not popularly elected. Then state government should ensure that all the local bodies switch over to the unit area method or capita value method for the assessment of property tax in time bound manner. Then private township and gated communities must be placed under the jurisdiction of concerned local body and subject to its laws, rules and bylaws. However, they can have autonomy for provisions of infrastructure and services within their precincts or collection of taxes and charges. Okay, then two more. Local bodies should be given responsibilities for water supply and distribution in their territorial jurisdiction. Okay, here one. The next one, city development plan and zoning regulations once approved should remain in force for 10 years. No authority should normally have any power to change it. Why 10 years? Because this is required for the basic development, because development projects will have some gestation period which cannot be completed within 5 years. So even if government change, like in the municipalities, the plan should continue for 10 years. Then apart from this AR's recommendations, we have four more recommendations, that there should be separate Mahila Sabha, which should be organized before or after Gram Sabha and Ward Sabha, so that women can come forward and tell their problems to the representatives. Then there should be alternative source of funding, like municipal bonds should be encouraged, because government cannot provide the required funding for the infrastructure. Then convergence of the schemes through leadership capabilities development at the grassroots level should be implemented. Okay. And the last one, Mohalla Committee model of Bhiwandi should be replicated to reduce riot-like situations. So these are also significant recommendations you can add. Now we are almost towards the end. See, these are the interesting concepts and terms which you can use in your introduction and conclusions. These terms, if you read carefully, first one, local service delivery. Then decentralization and inter-administrative relation. Okay, these are like technically sounding terms, inter-administrative relations. Then fiscal decentralization and local finances. Then gender responsiveness, as we discussed Mahila Sabha. Then leadership and municipal management, as we discussed direct election of the mayor. Then multi-level water governance. See, water is a state subject, so again it should be devolved to the district and gram panchayat level. Then integrity and anti-corruption. See, governance at the grassroots level should be free of the corruption, so that the leaders which are coming from the grassroots will be corruption free. Then next, disaster management and resilience. Local bodies are the one first one to respond to the disaster management, so they should be made strong. Then citizen participation and inclusive governance. Then sub-national conflict and peace building. Sub-national conflict is very important, especially in the time when there is a scarcity of water and there is a sharing of the rivers between the two sub-national entities, means basically states, okay, or maybe major cities. Then local economy development, this is very important, local disposal. Then lobby and advocacy, this is banned in India, so this pick is basically taken from some other country development. This is not available, possible in India, lobby and advocacy. This human rights and rule of law, this should be promoted through the local governance. So these are the interesting concepts which you can use in your introductions and your answers. Okay, so we are at the end. This is the statement by Mahatma Gandhi which you can use for your essay and for your conclusion also. We hope you found this video relevant from the UPSC point of view. We are working on other AIS reports related videos as well. Please share your feedback with us. We will share our contact in description box. Also, let us know in comment box on which topics we should make videos for you to make your UPSC journey easier. We wish you all the best and great success. Thank you so much.